Good afternoon. I'm Denise Dinsai, and here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. At least three reported dead in Davao region due to tropical depression Agaton. House lawmaker Litio Atienza no longer backing out of the vice presidential race. And the Commission on Elections looking to add more voting precincts in Hong Kong after a chaotic first day of the overseas absentee voting. Welcome to the program. For those watching online, thanks for joining us. At least three people were reported killed in Davao region due to floods triggered by tropical depression Agaton. Two of the victims were from Davao de Oro, while an 83-year-old man from Katil in Davao Oriental reportedly drowned. Disaster officials are still verifying the reports. Damage to agriculture in the region also pegged at millions of pesos.
Umabot na po doon sa production areas natin, no, that covers rice, corn, and even high value crops. Umaabot na po ito ng mahigit 100 million ang damage to this particular crops and production areas.
A state of calamity has been declared in Katil town. At least one area there is still isolated.
May mga minimal landslide naman po, sir, sa National Highway, pero nagawa naman po ng paraan. Na-deploy po tayo ng team with the help of the DPWH. Ang tinututukan po natin ngayon is yung isang area po sa barangay Maglahos kung naging island po as of this time kasi naputol yung naging isang access road nila.
Over in Leyte, more than 100 villages in 19 municipalities are flooded due to continuous rains brought by Agaton. Leyte Governor Leopoldo Petilio said the hardest hit areas are the municipality of Abuyog and Baybay City. There are also reports of landslides and flash floods in some towns. He says continuous downpour are complicating rescue efforts, especially since the province is still reeling from the effects of Typhoon Odette that struck in December.
Normally, ang people here are, it's not just the government, the local governments, but also the people are always ready considering na parat tayong tinatamaan ng mga bagyo. Take note, we're still recovering from from Odette. Yung weather natin seems to be changing. No? I mean, this is already April. Normally, ang April natin dito sa Leyte is very, very hot. This is totally different ng April ngayon na talagang since I think last week, no? Last week, maulan na dito, tuloy-tuloy ang ulan.
A state of calamity also declared in Cebu City due to the storm. While Cebu City is currently not under any wind signal warnings, rains brought by Agaton have already triggered floods and landslides in several areas. Mayor Michael Ramos says they're monitoring a possible high tide, which may exacerbate the flooding. He is also appealing to the Commission on Elections to exempt calamity funds from the election spending ban.
I don't think they should be too much being strict, even those that have been affected by Odette. We apologize because of community restriction. There are still ayudas that we need to give to those that we already have validated. In fact, a million worth, 20,000 beneficiaries. We have filed our petition, but I wish petitions should not be necessary because these are all facts. There are figures that houses are still to be attended to. There are figures that there are beneficiaries that cannot be receiving their benefits because of the restriction.
The poll body, meanwhile, says the petitions are necessary for the distribution of calamity aid. But COMELEC Commissioner George Garcia has a suggestion on expediting the process.
We are fully aware of the presence of calamity and there are certain calamity funds allotted for this kind of incidents. But if only the LGUs, without particularly naming the LGUs, can immediately go to the Commission of Election, file something with the COMELEC, we can expedite everything. We can even forego hearing on the case and based on the evidence available and what we we can always take cognizance of the fact that indeed there was a storm, there was a calamity, then we can immediately grant any request for expenditure. Perhaps initially what they can do is, this is just an advice, just inform our local COMELEC. Inform our local COMELEC that we wanted to help our constituents. Medyo wala na sila, wala na silang makain, wala silang mainom. We would like to help them pending the filing of a formal petition with us.
The Interior Department focusing on helping local government units affected by Agaton. Interior Undersecretary Jonathan Malaya says the agency is ready to assist in rescue and rehabilitation efforts. He also says the Interior Department has activated emergency operations centers to address the concerns of LGUs. Agaton has already displaced over 3,700 families across the Visayas and Mindanao.
Bago pa po dumating itong bagyong Agaton ay na-activate na ng DILG yung aming emergency operation centers. At meron po din kaming regional operation center para sa mga lugar kung saan paparating yung bagyo. So na-activate na at nakapag-issue na po kami ng warnings and advisory sa lahat ng mga LGUs na para palakasin yung kanilang disaster preparedness. Ngayon naman po ay nakikipag-ugnayan na kami sa NDRRMC. Tututok naman po kami sa rescue and rehabilitation immediately after matapos ng bagyo.
Tropical Depression Agaton slightly weakens as it remains almost stationary over San Pablo Bay. It's now packing sustained winds of 45 kilometers per hour and gusts of up to 60 kilometers per hour. But several parts of Mindanao and Visayas remain under storm signal number one. Meanwhile, International Tropical Cyclone Malakas continues to move closer to the Philippine area of responsibility. It's expected to enter the country later tonight or early Tuesday as a typhoon and will be given the local name Basha. But Weather Bureau Pagasa says Malakas is unlikely to directly affect the Philippines. The Commission on Elections may release its decision on the disqualification cases against presidential candidate Bongbong Marcos this week at the earliest. A total of 7 petitions were filed against the candidacy of Marcos. 6 have been junked by different COMELEC divisions, and several motions for reconsideration are pending before the en banc. The COMELEC earlier said it will decide on the cases this April.
Hopefully, we'll be able to promulgate the decision, at least the en banc cases, before the end of the third week of April, so that whoever will lose in that in these cases can go to the Supreme Court. Definitely, these cases will reach the Supreme Court in view of certain legal issues involved. The COMELEC will be limited only to the records on file, to the evidence presented so far, as far as these cases are concerned, unless there will be new petitions to be filed before the Commission on Election. But surely, any other evidence at this point will no longer be admitted because it's already in the motion for reconsideration stage. If anything, if any evidence can be accommodated still, it should have been filed when the case is still in the division level, not in the en banc case.
House lawmaker Lito Atienza no longer backing out of the vice presidential race. He's also rejecting Senator Ping Lacson's counteroffer of having Senate President Vicente Soto III as a common candidate for him and Senator Manny Pacquiao. Atienza explained his earlier offer was for both him and Lacson to withdraw from the race to make way for a new tandem that can strengthen the opposition. Atienza now warns a status quo on the presidential race will only boost the bid of Bongbong Marcos.
The affair with Ping and me is done. Kung hindi siya mag-step back, hindi walang vacancy. I am not interested in the vice presidency. I'm interested in preventing Mr. Marcos to become the next president of the land. And there will be no change. He is sure as elected. But I'm warning the whole nation, the realization that another Marcos regime forthcoming will cause a national crisis. Not only national, but international. we will be the talk of the international stage. How can the Filipinos do that? My God, they haven't even recovered the lost money of yesteryears, and they're putting another Marcos in charge. That is very embarrassing.
An update now on the overseas absentee voting. The COMELEC looking to add more voting precincts in Hong Kong. This is in response to complaints of a chaotic first day of absentee voting for Filipinos in the city. Currently, there are only 5 polling precincts in Hong Kong, even if the city has over 93,000 registered voters. COMELEC Commissioner George Garcia says this issue will be addressed in their en banc meeting this Tuesday.
Actually, there are additional 5 more vote counting machines available to our post. There are 4 additional and 1 on standby basis. So there are actually 10 vote counting machines, but it's actually the decision of the post to establish only 5 precincts. By tomorrow, we will have our en banc meeting and surely it will be discussed, and we will push for an increase in the number of precincts in order to allow more Filipino voters to vote. And number 2, not to offend the sensitivities of the Hong Kong authorities, especially that we are fully aware of the COVID-19 situation in the territory.
For a Filipino leader in Hong Kong, the Philippine government should be held accountable for the issues being encountered there.
From the onset, may problem na kasi we used to have 10 BCMs, no, in the previous elections. And you can just imagine, this election is a national election, and historically, we have more voters turnout during presidential elections. Mm-hmm. So, the government should have expected a higher turnout. And instead of reducing the number of BCMs, they should have added more.
Over in the U.S., delays mar the start of the overseas absentee voting in several states. Election materials like ballots and vote counting machines have yet to be fully delivered in New York. Philippine officials expect the completion of deliveries and final testing of election processes by April 13. Absentee voting for Filipinos in Los Angeles, meanwhile, has yet to begin. The Philippine Consulate in L.A. says the first batch of ballots may arrive by Thursday or Friday, but they don't expect a high voter turnout for the 2022 elections.
Ang ating expected turnout, based on historical data, is only 15% of the total registered voters. So if we're talking of 36,000 total registered voters for a Philippine Consulate General in Los Angeles, we are expecting only about 5,000 actual voters na boboto talaga. And medyo nakakalungkot, mababa.
A foreign affairs official says other American states are also dealing with same election issues.
Dito po sa mga nakaraang linggo at nakaraang araw, ay hindi naman po lahat ito, pero sa ngayon po, meron pa rin po mga 8 na mga post namin, embassy at consulate, na hindi pa rin po nakakatanggap ng kanilang voting kit at ballots, dahil na rin po nga ito ay nanggagaling po sa COMELEC sa Manila at sila po ang nag-aayos with the freight forwarder.
We're taking a quick break. Coming up, sharp contractions are expected from the economies of Russia and Ukraine amid the ongoing war in Europe. More on that when we come back. Death toll from a missile strike on a train station in Ukraine's Kramatorsk rises to 57. The casualties were civilians, mostly women and children, who were racing to flee the Donbas region ahead of Russia's offensive. 109 other people were wounded in that attack, which Ukraine is blaming on Russia. But Moscow denied responsibility, saying the missile was Ukrainian. 6 weeks into Russia's invasion, Moscow has since shifted its focus to eastern and southern Ukraine after stiff resistance thwarted its plans to swiftly capture Kyiv. Russian forces fired rockets into Ukraine's Luhansk and Dnipro regions Sunday. At least 5 people were injured, while an airport was destroyed. Emergency workers are combing through another facility that was hit in search for any survivors. Ukraine's economy is likely to contract at a staggering pace this year due to Russia's invasion. Based on its latest report, the World Bank says Ukraine's GDP will likely shrink by 45%, excluding the impact of physical infrastructure destruction. And that magnitude is still subject to a high degree of uncertainty related to the duration and intensity of the war. As for Russia, World Bank expects its economy to contract 11% due to punishing financial sanctions imposed by the U.S. and its Western allies. The Eastern Europe region, comprising Ukraine, Belarus, and Moldova, is also forecast to show a GDP contraction of 30.7% this year due to shocks from the war and disruption of trade. The Philippine Central Bank, meanwhile, continues to allay fears over the impact of Russia's invasion of Ukraine to the local economy. BSP Governor Benjamin Diokno asserts the economic fallout from the war on the Philippine economy is limited for three reasons. The country's distance from the conflict area, its limited business links to both Ukraine and Russia, and its strong macroeconomic fundamentals. Diokno says Manila's combined exports to Moscow and Kyiv only amounted to $125 million in 2021 out of the $74 billion total exports last year. In terms of remittances, Diokno points out less than 1% of the country's total remittances for 2021 were from Russia and Ukraine. The Philippine Health Department says it's impossible to achieve herd immunity against COVID-19 at this time. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergeres says what the DOH is trying to achieve now is population protection. This means giving priority to the most vulnerable, such as senior citizens, people with comorbidities, healthcare workers, and children.
It's impossible for us to achieve herd immunity at this time because first, the protection from the vaccines are waning. So you cannot have that kind of protection for long. Second, we only have reached about 70% of those eligible in the population, meaning there are still sectors who are not vaccinated, like those less than 5 years old, are not eligible for vaccination yet.
Health authorities are now seeking the approval of the Food and Drug Administration for booster shots of children aged 12 to 17. DOH spokesperson Vergeres says they are also seeking the FDA's nod for a possible fourth dose for the general population. Once the amendments get released, the DOH will issue guidelines for the rollout of the additional jabs. Out of the 66 million Filipinos who are eligible for a booster shot, only about 12 million have received the additional jab. Local pump prices set for a second straight week of rollbacks. Kerosene will see the biggest price cut of 3 pesos per liter on Tuesday. Gasoline prices will go down by 1 peso, while a liter of diesel will cost 35 centavos less. The decline follows lower trading prices at the world market last week after China extended its COVID-19 lockdown on top of Russian forces retreating from some key Ukrainian cities. Meanwhile, power rates are also set to go up this April due to higher generation charge. Meralco customers with a typical household consumption of 200 kilowatts per hour will see a 107 peso increase in their bill this month. Twitter's biggest shareholder, Elon Musk, has decided not to join its board. That's according to the company's chief executive, Parag Agrawal. He believes the decision is for the best, though he notes the company will remain open to Musk's inputs. Musk, for his part, limited his response to an emoji of a face with a hand over its mouth. The Tesla boss earlier this month disclosed an over 9% stake on Twitter and said he plans to bring about significant improvements at the social media platform. But reports say some Twitter employees panicked at the prospect of Musk taking a board seat. And that's the rundown. I'm Denise Dinsai. Thank you so much for watching. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.